It is basically a PDA, push-down automata, and this is one of my favorite diagram. So this is your basically a finite state machine, and this is the delta transition function. This is the input tape. So all your sentence, the terminals are here. It must be terminated by a end of a blank. So this may be your, whenever C is one blank, the blank in Sipsen's book it is B hash, or in some other books different. So that indicates like your C language backslash n, it shows a null character, like this kind of one specially designated symbol should be in the input tape. It shows the end of input. So but that should not occur in the within the sentence, and the tape can go left to right. And another thing is that this is the infinite stack, and the end of stack marker in Sipsen's book it is dollar, and in some other book it is zero. So either end of stack, but there should be one end of stack marker, preferably in most of the books it is dollar. Dollar is the end of stack marker. So definitely there is one question, can dollar be input tape? Yes, it can be or cannot be. It is better not. It is better to avoid dollar here. But these input tape alphabets and stack alphabets may be totally different, unlike Turing machine. So input alphabet we signify here sigma. It consists of the finite set of symbols as input terminals. Basically, symbols are terminals that can occur in the sentences without, and blank is the end of string marker, and this is we call a gamma. And gamma, because we can put A here as a capital A like this, so we can have separate alphabets, so we can make it a gamma. And gamma consists of dollar. We all only push or pop. So at any, even at any state of time, the machine can see only the input and only the top of the stack, not the bottom, the top of the stack, and this is the state at which the FSM is there. Then it decides whether it whether this here, this symbol is to be pushed in transform. Like if it is A, we can push it in capital A, like A to the power n, B to the power n. Whenever it sees A, then it want to push it, and whenever the B is coming, for every B it can pop the capital A, and say at the end of the, when it comes, if it is A to the power n and B to the power n, see it have a 4 A's and 4 B's. So when the first A is there, it push A, second A push A, capital A, not the same A, because stack alphabets is a different. Then third A, fourth A, then whenever the 1 B comes, then it pops the last in first out A, not the BC. Then the another B comes, then this A, then another B comes third, then it comes last, then whenever it comes fourth B, then the last A comes out, and it will automatically come at the end of tape. It should come at the end of tape, and stack should be empty. So remember, not only this, so this final state machine should be in acceptive state, and it should be at the end of it, and the stack should empty. Then we say that it is accepting. Otherwise, any other condition, say it is stack is not empty, or it is in not accepted state, then we say this push down automata is rejecting the sentence. This is one, there are several other schematic diagram also, and state description we will discuss. One thing you must notice, the difference between the FSM and Turing machine. FSM, we do not have stack. So that is it. And it only moves left to right, and it can go only to accepting state. So that is the reason we can get the language, we can recognize the language A to the power n B, or A B to the power n, or A to the power m B to the power n, wrong relation between m and n. So that can be without stack, but stack is needed whenever we want to a number of, say, A to the power n, B to the power n, or in Sipsen's book it is 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n, same language, or balance parenthesis, we need a stack here. And so here this is, and but in a Turing machine, remember this, this cannot, this can only read and can go only left right, same as finite state machine, but which has only stack. But Turing machine, and another thing is, it can go back, but in Turing machine it can go back, it can go forward, but only one step. It can write also on the tape, so there is no stack in Turing machine. We have already partly proved or demonstrative that Turing machine is more capable. More capable means maybe A to the power n, B to the power, not maybe, A to the power n, B to the power language, this push-down automata can accept it much faster. But Turing machine is more capable, is more powerful, that it can recognize more languages, like not only A to the power n, B to the power n, it is WW language, A to the power n, B to the power n, C to the power n language, or A to the power n, B to the power n, C to the power n, D to the power n language. These all languages are context sensitive grammar, that is means it's a type on grammar. Or WW grammar, that is a linear bounded automata, that is a type 1 grammar, and then also the type 0 grammar. And we know that we discussed the type 0 grammar. We have two kinds of type 0 grammar, that is Turing decidable and Turing recognizable. So dollar sign is more or less universally all accepted in all books. Dollar sign is the end of stack marker, push down automata, though it's infinite, but there should be some end of stack marker. And remember, when the push-down automata accesses the string, the only Z0 or dollar should be there. No other symbol should push and pop all. So it should be, stack should be empty, your input head should be at the right end, and the this P should be in the accepted state of the finite state machine. Then we call the PD accept sentence. But you might wonder, what is the parse tree? We know that PDA is essential for generating you have to generate parse tree, because if you say at the end accept, then every programming want to know how this terminals is being generated from the start symbol. That parse tree is required. So this particular configuration doesn't give the parse. So you need another machine, another pushdown machine for getting the parse tree. So it's only say accept or reject. If it is accepted, then we have mainly two algorithms that we have discussed. One is LL1, that is top down approach. So we start from the start symbol and try to reach the sentence. By one way is brute force techniques. You just fire one rule and see whether it's matched. If it is not, then you go back. But that is very cumbersome. That is not followed. But maybe 1%, maybe 0.1% rule we can follow the brute force technique, not for context free grammar, because we know the context free grammar we have little modification. So if we avoid the left recursion means grammar always starts with the same variable, like S small terminal A, that is a left recursion. The variable again comes on the right hand side of the front. So left recursion is to be avoided. If the left recursion is there, then it will be brute force technique. And brute force technique, you cannot have any time limitation. It can go exponential time. And not only that, it will take exponential space in your main memory. So brute force technique is always avoided. So we can modify the grammar so that it doesn't have any left recursive and certain other restriction. Then it can be top-down approach, that is LL1. And another is bottom-up approach. So we can go from right to left. And we can reach to the S, that is more powerful, that is LR1 approach. But that comes after we accepting the string. Whether the string is accepted, then we have another configuration of machine. And that machine should be specially configured, and there should be, that is it. And another great thing about LL1 grammar and LR1 grammar, so this machine can be generated by the program itself. There is already a program. That is, this program is yet another compiler. That program is available in Linux machine. And there are other programmers also. That if the programmers, you input your production rules of the context-free grammar. You put it in a format, and automatically the program would be generated. The parser program. That parser program, you can run it on your CPU. So that is great. So that is the powerful of nature of this context-free grammar. So this parser, it is not accepting, it is a much simpler machine. But for parsing, you need a parsing means you have not only accept or reject, you have to give a parse tree in a pointer, you know, in C, or you have to make tree like structure, and that has to be generated by a parser. And this parser generated in almost all languages automatically. So it is the computer scientist's role is there to understand the context-free grammar and make the rules only that language. Then the automatically this parser will be generated. This is I am following the Michael Simpson's book Context-Free Language in Free Grammar. This is the context-free grammar. And one thing I say that is, it gives the 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n. Whenever you see this kind of parse tree, it is always, it must be unambiguous. Like it is here 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n grammar. This is the parse tree, and this is also called face structure grammar. Your regular grammar is also a face structure grammar, but it doesn't have that feature. Then you can put in into regular grammar, but in here the face structured grammar, it is invented by Noam Chomsky in 1957. Like you can put a sentences, English sentences is noun phrase and verb phrase. The verb phrase can have a noun phrase and verb phrase again. So like our English language, the English language is a perfect example of a context free grammar. You can put in verb phrase in the again noun phrase and verb phrase. This is one example. The context-free grammar is the best example. Your context-sensitive grammar also face structure grammar, and definitely context-free grammar is the type 2 grammar. It has two parts, deterministic context-free and non-deterministic context-free. Deterministic context-free example is a to the power n, b to the power n. Here, Michael Simpson used 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n. This is the language. Balance parenthesis is a one best example, and another is expression grammar. That is, these are the three main examples that any programming language consists of, mainly expression grammar and balance grammar. And A to the power N, B to the power N, basically a grammar is for easy understanding, but expression grammar is more useful. This is, I want to give you an example. This is from the Michael Simpson book. Say, this is the English, it is English language example. Like a sentence, any sentence consists of a noun phrase and verb phrase. Noun phrase can consist complex noun or prepositional phrases. And you can see the article can be A or B or maybe an. Noun phrase, say boy, girl and flower. Verb is touches like sees and preposition is like with. With this, you can generate a good amount of sentence. Repeated in introduction. And you can see this is basically nothing but a context-free grammar. Why? Because this left hand side all are variables and they don't come with any other variable and no other terminal, and right hand side two variable or terminal, single terminal. So this basically, you see, right now all rules are Chomsky's normal form, because right hand side only two variable. If it is more than T, definitely not Chomsky's normal form. And one great beauty of it, that all context-free grammar can be converted to Chomsky's normal form. That is great. There is no exception. But if any, that particular grammar, if the particular variable can go to epsilon, we know how to modify it so that only the start variable can go to epsilon. We have done this exercise. Just to repeat it, that so any context-free grammar, including non-deterministic context-free grammar and deterministic context-free grammar, can be converted to Chomsky's normal form. Another form is Graybeck normal form, but more practical uses is Chomsky's normal form. That is, but he is the main inventor of the face structure grammar. I repeat, the face structure grammar consists of type 0 grammar, type 1 grammar, type 2 grammar, type 3 grammar. Face structure grammar means its recursiveness is there, so I can have built-in recursion. But whenever this is a recursion, when we have the left hand side of the single variable, then we call a context free grammar, and we can have a meaningful sentences. The more almost, and this is also parsing, is, you know, O to the O, O N, we can modify. Say these are the sentences. A boy sees, the boy sees a flower, a girl with a flower likes a boy, like this. These are the simple sentences can be parsed meaningfully, not only generated by the grammar and accepted by the grammar. Probably we have more or less trace on acceptance of the grammar, but we have to find it how to generate it. There will be a generator side and there will be acceptance side. Generator side is sometimes easy, but accepting is more or less difficult. A generator, very easy, just fire the rules and get it. But accepting it, not only accepting, getting the parse tree, that is difficult. Accepting is again a linear. Whether accept or reject, you don't know back and forth in context-free grammar. So you just go left to right, it, and the end of the sentence, the stack should empty, and there should be no further. So you go at the end of the tape, only the blank symbol is there, and your finite state machine has gone to the accepting state. If any of the situation is not there, so stack is not empty and finite state machine not at the control unit, that is sometimes it's, you see the control unit. Finite state machine in Michael's itself is control unit. It is not in accepting state, so it will reject. That's it. So that is called accepting. It must, in context free grammar, I have repeatedly told you O in Q, but for deterministic context free grammar and for programming languages, we, by clever technique, we can make it as a O in. Says how the sentence is formed. So these are the context free grammar four tuple. In some books it can be say NT. NT is, means non-terminal. Variable is this. Sigma is input alphabet. In some books it might say P. P for production rules. And here is the rules. Same. And S is the start value. This four tuple is same for type 3 grammar, type 1 grammar, type 2 grammar, type 1, type 0 grammar. By looking at the rules only, you can declare the grammar is type 3 grammar or type 2 grammar or type 1. These are four tuples only by looking at the rules. So, if we see the rules at the right hand side, only single terminal or the variable at the end, one variable at the end, you can say it is a right linear grammar, that is a regular grammar, or all rules, the right hand side, only one terminal or start with a left hand side a variable, then we call a left linear grammar, again regular grammar. But if we see in a rules, there is a mix of left and right, then you definitely it cannot be regular grammar, it must be type 2. But whether this type 2 grammar is a deterministic context free grammar or non-deterministic context free grammar, so we know these are the characteristics of deterministic context free grammar, and like palindromes, and there are lots, not only palindromes, there are lots of other grammars are non-deterministic context free grammar. In fact, maybe number of more non-deterministic context free grammar is more powerful. Parsing is NP complete. Another thing is that this is the grammar, it is a parenthesis grammar. You can see that it is a parenthesis grammar. If you how to see the parenthesis grammar, if you see put instead of A, put the left parenthesis and B the right parenthesis, then it will be looks like a parenthesis grammar. It has said if A is a left parenthesis, this is parenthesis grammar. This one I try to give you an example. This is the expression grammar. Expression grammar means all our infix notation in our programming languages, you all encounter that our symbol is comes in between, not like postfix, because we know human can understand infix notation better, but computer can understand postfix notation. If you put your expression in postfix notation, you don't need any bracket. But we generally, most of the programming languages give you the power in the infix notation, because if you have to, programmer has to fight it to put the sentence in the postfix, it will be tougher for programmer, because you remember programming time are more costly, programmer are more costly. So for expression grammar, this is the, you can ask why it is not expression plus expression, why you go for another terminal, terminal into factor, because we have given more importance here for multiplication sign. So that is the reason that this rule is first will be fired and then this rule. Okay, plus, generally plus is always, even if you use bracket, there will be no confusion. If there is no bracket, we must expect that if any expression, the multiplication comes first. Unary operator first, then the unary operator means square and all this, and then comes binary operator like plus or multiplication. The multiplication should be computed first, then the plus sign. It has a higher precedence. So if we see this is the tree, so definitely you can say this, we want this, we do not want this. Then if you have the plus sign, then you have to put a bracket. If you want, really want, the A plus A should be evaluated first, then we should use parenthesis, separate parenthesis. Then it will be evaluated first. Otherwise, we should prefer, definitely it will be. We want the multiplication should be the first thing. Two parts tree, which parts tree we should use? Definitely this one, because here calculated a plus and here it is not, because plus is calculated first. You should not want. For this, we have the expression grammar. And you see that your leftmost derivation should be one and only tree. This I already covered. A string W is derived ambiguously in context free grammar G if has two or more different leftmost derivation. Grammar G is ambiguous if it generates some string ambiguously. Maybe 99% case it is unambiguous, because even a 1 it is ambiguous, then we call the grammar is ambiguous. Another thing I have told, a language can have many grammars. We have to find it out which one is the unambiguous grammar. Then we say language is unambiguous. A language can have ambiguous grammar also. Ambiguous grammar is no use. But we know certain languages are there, we will come to this, that they are inherently ambiguous. You cannot find an unambiguous grammar. We come to this, like a to the power I, b to the power j, c to the power k, either a is equal to j or j is equal to k. This is basically nothing but a context free grammar, but it is inherently ambiguous. You cannot find unambiguous grammar for this. It is written it here, like this grammar. A to the power I, B to the power J, C to the power K, either I is equal to J or J is equal to K. This is inherently ambiguous. So this kind of grammar we should avoid it, because we know non-deterministic Poisson automata can accept this, but realization of non-deterministic Poisson automata is very, very hard in a hard way. So we always try to have a deterministic Poisson automata. Theoretical discussion we should take care of, because we have seen non-deterministic finite state machine has the same power as deterministic finite state machine. Only non-deterministic finite state machine will help you to capture from the regular expression. Then we have algorithms to make it non-deterministic finite state machine to phi FSM. So we don't bother about non-deterministic finite state machine. It will give you only the fewer state, and we know whenever we are putting into a hardware, there definitely a deterministic finite state machine with minimum number of states, and that should be unique one. Maybe name convention may be different, but state name and the state number of state and the data transition functions would be the same and unique. So then we say regular grammar, finite state machine, regular expression, all are same, but that cannot be seen in Poisson automata. Non-deterministic Poisson automata correspond to non-deterministic context free grammar, which are more powerful for deterministic Poisson automata, deterministic context free grammar. But remember, even a deterministic context free grammar can be ambiguous. So we have to again search it and see it, that grammar is really unambiguous. If it is really unambiguous, then you have to see whether the grammar is compatible with LL1 grammar or LR1 grammar. So we know LL1 grammar is the smallest set. So most of our programming languages are basically LR1 grammar. So after reading the sentences from left to right, we say whether you have accepted it. Then we have another machine pushed on the automata. Then we say right to left, we get the parse tree, that is LR1. And if it is on left side, we generate a parse tree, we call it LL1 grammar. Great benefit of this, both the grammars, the parsing routine, the soft, all these things can be generated by another program. That is, like one example is YAC, that is one for yet another compiler. Full name is yet another compiler. That is written in, again in C. That input is your only the rules, grammar rules in Bacchus-Noah form, and automatically the program would be generated. So that is the computer scientist's role. How to simplify your context-free grammar? You first have to, any context-free grammar is given to you, you don't jump first context Chomsky's number form. You see which are the symbols are unreachable, unnecessary, useless symbol. Any variable which cannot go into the end of the, which cannot go to the terminal, or then we can forget those rules and we can cut those rules. Then unreachable symbol and all these things. Then we have a new start variable S0, and we eliminate epsilon rules one at a time, then upside, and then whenever the left hand side, we can combine two variables. If you see the right hand side, three variables, we put last two variables, say another new variable, so we make it into Chomsky's number form. So we have done this in our class examples. First, you have to go for leaving all the unnecessary variables, unnecessary get rid of the new start symbol. Then you take one variable to epsilon, because we know only S can go start and can go to epsilon. We eliminate one epsilon rules, not together, so one at a time. We simplify the rules. Then you can see right hand side, maybe three variables or four variables together with terminal. Then we combine two variables, a single variable, so that it can conform to Chomsky's number form, and it will be very so all these very advantages for generating the computer program. You can see the Michael Sifter's book. This is Michael Sifter's notation of Pushdown automata. This is the description, whatever. This is a definition of Pushdown automata. So this is basically a tuple for non-deterministic Pushdown automata. You can see how we can see is in a, because you see the epsilon, your input alphabet can got epsilon, and your stack alphabet can go to epsilon, and P is the power set. So this is the most general form of Pushdown automata, but sometimes it difficult. So this is a six tuple of Pushdown automata. In some books, dollar sign is there or Z0 is there, seven tuple, the basically same. Here it is not there, because ultimately is a dollar or Z0, it is in the stack alphabets. So you do not, but in some books is shown that the stack alpha in the stack marker, like Q0 is the start set, you have to mention Q0. Some books it is a dollar or Z0, so seven tuple. But here delta transition function, the input alphabet consists of the null string as well. Your stack alphabet is also null string as well, so that input state from any state P to any state, it can jump without consuming an input and without consuming a push or pop. So that is keep immense powerful, and that can absorb palindrome, but it is difficult to understand. So we will start our next class the configuration, like whatever we have done in the configuration of Turing machine. Same thing can be machine configuration can be written in state, so that you can have, there are several convention in use. You can specifically mention push and pop, which variable you are and which state, and what you are pushing and popping, and whether you have to only left to right, and which state you are jumping further. And there we first cover deterministic Pushdown automata, then we will try to absorb non-deterministic Pushdown automata.